typically you do need a little bit of background information, what a canal looks like, how it releases water, things about irrigation tanks. So in the initial part, I'll just try to explain a few things about that. A canal network, typically you can see that there's a dam over there, that's the blue color, right? And then you have this long canal coming out of it like that. Now that's a main canal, right? And from the main canal you have these branches coming out, and they are the branch canals. And typically from these branch canals, you have, it's not shown in the figure, but you'll have more canals coming out, and those are called distributaries. So this is not a hard and fast rule, in the sense you could have just one main canal, or maybe just two branch canals, and then you could have a lot of distributaries and so on. What does a canal actually look like? Now, typically we would think that the top view over there, is what we generally imagine a canal to be. You know, the sides are lined with some kind of cement mortar. There's a little bit too much of vegetation here. But if you look at the figures below, that's the same canal, but it's much, much deeper. It's not near the ground at all. It's far down below. And if you look at the picture next to it, right, you can see a sort of cross section of the view. This part is actually the part that is lined. Okay? This part, the bottom, and this part. All the rest of it is just plain soil like that. So when it rains, you have a lot of soil getting eroded, falling into this area. That's why there's so much vegetation there. There's a lot of soil over there. So when it rains, typically, because you have this canal that deep down below, you have a lot of erosion. And what this causes is you could also have a problem of the canal lining being broken like this. You see the soil is slid over here, right? And the canal lining has given way. Now when this happens, you have a lot of deposit of silt, it's an obstruction for the water to flow and so on. Another view of the same canal, here you have a road going over the canal, right? And because there's a road going over the canal, there's a lot of soil that's been piled up. And the canal is actually right here, right at the base. Now this is a culvert, it's a box culvert. It looks, if you look at it straight, this is what it looks like. And this is the space for the water to flow. Now each of these, for example, a culvert like this is a place where if you have a lot of debris, water just gets blocked and it just flows. So every time that water is let into a canal, it's not just going to smoothly flow. There are all kinds of obstructions in the way. There's a lot of silt that is smaller than everything. So it's even just sit back and wait and watch until the water comes. Mm-hmm. You have to do a lot of things earlier. You have to make sure that it does reach your village or your tank. How is it that canals really? This is just another view of the what it looks like down below. The same box cover. So this is the canal, right? Because you have the road going right through. Whenever you have a canal in land, in undulating land, you have two kinds of situations. In one situation, the ground level is pretty low. So what happens is you actually construct a bund like this, and the canal is going through it like that. What this means, and this is an example of that. You have the canal here, but you have all these pipes here, and this land is actually low-lying land. So whenever there is water in the canal, if you just put a pipe in there, water will just simply flow out because the ground level is much lower than the water level. I don't know if that's clear. If you see the water level is here and the ground level is here, so if you just put a pipe, right, you could just like you have a tank, right, and a tank with water, the water will just flow out. So it doesn't need any power, it runs day and night, there's no problem. But are canals meant to be used like that? This particular canal is not supposed to be used like that. But some farmers gain because their land is in low lying areas. On the other hand, you have the canal going way down deep, way far below the lake. This is the ground level and this is the floor of the sand somewhere here. There are all kinds of trees looking in it, as you can see. So when you have to lift water from this, it's not so easy. But the way this particular canal is designed is that actually the canal is supposed to release water through what's called an escape gate. Right? So you have the canal going, and at certain points you have what are called escape gates. So this is what an escape gate looks like. This is just to give you an idea of the scale. This is a small escape gate, and what it has is it has some screw on it. This screw is a little better visible here. So this, if you turn the screw, this gate will rise. And as the gate rises, the canal, the water flowing in the canal is like out into the adjoining area. So if you turn it by 1 foot turn, it will change its level by what is called pumping, right? Now this is obviously not a very simple task. You can't just do it with your hand, right? So you need some levers. Now this is a small escape gate, so maybe one person could do it. But if you have a large escape gate, you need 3 people to turn it and it's small. And there's a locking system to make sure that nobody else that it's not misused. So having seen that much about canals, let's just take get an idea of where we are. This is the distributory that we're talking about. And the pictures that we've seen and all that is about this distributory. This is what is called the branch canal, which I mentioned earlier. Now the branch canal will release, if this is an escape gate, when this escape gate is raised, water is let into this distributory. If the escape gate is closed, then there is no water flowing in this distributory. This distributory is supposed to release water to these tanks. You know, the number 1, 2, 3 and 4. These are what are called irrigation tanks. And all of South India is full of many of these tanks. In fact, Bangalore in the 60s had 280 tanks or so. But today everything has been built up and so on and so forth. So this particular distributory is supposed to feed these 4 tanks. That's the idea. If you look, and this time we have a little feel for what these tanks are, how important they are, what it means for agriculture and so on. If you look at Google map, you'll see something like this. And you'll see these blue colored tanks. These are irrigation tanks. There's some in black and so on. You also see that they're all sort of connected. If this tank is full, it will overflow and fall into this tank. And then it'll fall into this tank. So it's an integrated system of tanks. But actually there are tanks over here also. In fact, if you look at an area like this, if you look at it very carefully, you'll find that there are some more tanks over here. Now the tanks are not visible because this is summer. And in summer, those small tanks are probably dry. So they don't show up in color and they don't show up in blue. But if you look carefully at a Google map, actually there are lots and lots of tanks all over the place. Now, how extensive this system was, we get an idea of. So if you just draw a tank map, which shows only the tanks, you'll see that they're all interconnected, one flowing into the other. You'll also see that, in fact, it was such an extensive system that when the British arrived in India, 2.5 centuries ago, there were about 3 million tanks in South India, and they were irrigating about 4 million hectares. So when we talk about irrigation today, and we are only thinking about the dams, we should also remember that there was already existing an earlier irrigation system, possibly about 1000 years old, because we have inscriptions that tell us how old it is. I don't know, all of you may be familiar with the Sankey tank in Bangalore. Now the same Major Sankey writing in 1896 said that, you know, if the British were very good at measuring the numbers of tanks and how much level you will get out of it, they were meticulous about that. So there were actually some 37,000 tanks in Mysore and 42,000 in Madras Presidency. And he says such a vast system did not exist in any other part of the world. So this is the kind of tank system already existing in South India, okay, and functional in the most part even up to 30, 40 years ago. Now what happened was this is just to get an idea of what a tank actually looks like. It's one thing to look at a tank on a map, it's another thing to see what a tank looks like. This is a medium sized tank. If the tank is full, which happens towards the end of October generally, if it's a good monsoon, you'll see something like this. And this is used for fishing, irrigation, and also groundwater recharge. The uses of the tanks have changed over time. In the earlier days, you were able to grow paddy just below the tank. That was the only way you could grow paddy in this kind of semi-arid region. But now what has happened is all that has been given up, and now it's very important for recharging boreholes. So there are about 100 or 150 boreholes around this tank. And if this tank fills up 1 year, then the boreholes will deliver or not lose their water for another 2 years. So for farmers, it's very critical that their tank at least fill up, if not every year, every now and then. When the tank is dry, of course, it looks something like this. The same tank, when it's dry, it looks like this, and you wonder what is all this. But even as a dry tank, it has uses. For one thing, the soil moisture in the tank bed is much higher. So a lot of people use it for grazing, especially when you have a drought and all that, and other areas are dry. There will still be some amount of water available for cattle here. It's also used for the silt, fertile silt that is brought by the water in the tank. It's used to, is taken away for the various agricultural fields. So it has a lot of uses. It's still important. Its uses have changed over time, but it's still a very important for villagers. In fact, it's so important for villagers that if you have, this is a view of a tank when it's full, and you have this overflowing spillway over here. So this is a very small tank, and it got filled even last year. And a tank is literally so important to farmers today, even now, that a brimful tank is considered to be like a temple consecrated. So when you have, when you're building a temple, you have this final ceremony in which the temple is consecrated. Having a tank which is full to the brim is equivalent to that.